Hello, I'm Javier Toledo from Rush VFX. Welcome to this Houdini Pill. Today you are going to learn how to rotate vectors creating a curve banking system. The idea here is that the curve will detect a left or a right turn and it will rotate accordingly around the curve. So let's see what we will need here. So if we have a curve here, for example, we will need to detect this right turn here, this left turn here, and this aggressive left turn here. And we will need to know that this is a straight part. So how are we going to do this? The first thing we'll need is a coordinate system for every point in the curve. And this will be three vectors that will be the tangent, the up, and the side. The tangent will go in the direction of the curve. The up, since the idea here is that this will be a track or a road or a roller coaster, it will need to be as vertical as possible. And the side will be perpendicular between, well, it will all be perpendicular. So let's see how we can create this first step inside Houdini. Let's create a curve here. Yeah, NURBS curve. Okay, so we have this curve here. So first of all, we'll need to resample it to get more points here. For example, every 0.5 units. That's okay. So we'll create a visualized node with the three vectors that we will need. First, we'll create the tangent. Then the side.
And the up.
Okay, so let's see what the polyframe SOP will do. So if we make this the tan, this the side, and this the up, for example, we'll see that it creates perpendicular vectors, sort of, but it's not properly aligned, so it won't help us in this situation. So let's keep the tangent, since that's okay, that will work for us, and we will use a point wrangle to fix the polyframe. Okay. So here we'll start creating our up, pointing in the Y direction. And then we will fix it accordingly so it will be pointing where it should be pointing. So now, if we cross product the tangent and the up vector, we'll get a perpendicular vector here that will be our side, and that's exactly what we need. So if we create the side vector with a cross product between the up and the tangent, we'll have our side vector, and that's exactly how we need it. And now that we have this side and this tangent that are correct, we'll update the up vector with another cross product between this one and this one. So let's do it. So our new up vector will be another cross product between the side and the tangent. Okay, it's pointing downwards, so we'll swap this tangent cross product with the side. Okay, so now you can see we have this polyframe working correctly. When it goes up, this leans backwards, and when it goes down, it leans forwards. So here we are. Okay. So now that this polyframe is done, let's see how can we use it. Let's see, we have here our side vectors. And as you can see here, we have a clue of how we can detect every turn. So if the tip of these vectors is farther away than the root, we'll have a right turn. And if this tip gets closer, you see, we will have a left turn. And if it's roughly the same, we'll be in a straight curve. So to get this, for example, if we are in this point here, we'll need to get information from the previous and the next points. And if we are here, the previous and the next, the previous and the next. So we can compare it, this between this, and we'll get this curve information here. So first of all, we need to get this point IDs. And how are we gonna do this? Well, if we want to get the previous ID, we can do ptnum minus one. And we want to have the next ID, we can do ptnum plus one. But there's a small issue here. If we are in the first or in the last point, it won't have a previous or a next point. So we need to clamp this between zero and the num pt, being this the total number of points here. So let's get this information here. We'll create another point wrangle to keep things organized. Okay, so let's start with this. We have the int attribute called previous ID and the next ID. So this will be ptnum minus one, but we need to clamp it. So clamp this between zero and the num pt. And we'll copy paste it here. Ptnum plus one. So now we have this previous ID and next ID. So now that we know the ID for every previous and next point, we can get the position of these points and the side vectors for these points. And that's what we will need to get this to work. we'll use a point expression here to get this previous and next position. Okay, so we'll start here. We'll use the point from the first input. We'll get the position, and in the point number we'll use the previous ID. And we'll copy it next and next ID. Okay, so now we need to do the same, but instead of getting the P, we'll get the side vector. So we'll copy it, previous side and next side. So instead of P, get side, and everything is working. So now that we have this position and these vectors, we can add the position and the vector to get this displaced position here. So we'll have this point, and this point, and this point, and we will get the distances between them to make this work. So we'll start, we'll start with the previous displaced position, and this will be the previous position plus the previous side vector. And we'll copy it and write here the next displaced position, and there will be the next position plus the next side. And everything is working. So let's continue. So now we need to get two distances, two length of vectors. So this will be floats, and this will be the distance between the points. So that will be the length of a vector subtraction, and that will be the previous pos minus the next pos, and the displaced distance being the length between the previous displaced position minus the next displaced position. And everything's okay. As you can see, we subtract this and this to get this vector, and this to get this vector. So now that we have these two distances here, let's see how can we use it. So if we divide the displaced distance over the distance, two things can happen. So let's write here displaced dist over dist. Two things can happen. If this is bigger than this, we'll have a number bigger than one, and this will be a right turn. And if this is less than this, we'll get a number less than one, and this will be a left turn. And if this and this is roughly the same, we'll get a number near one. So we'll have this balance here of numbers below one and numbers over one. And it will be much better if we can make numbers below zero and over zero, because here we'll have negative numbers, meaning left, and we'll have positive numbers, meaning one. So we have to use this and subtract one from it. Okay, so let's do it in Houdini. We'll have this ratio attribute, and it's gonna be the displaced distance over the distance minus one. Okay, so you can see here that we have positive numbers and we have negative numbers, and the bigger the number is, the more extreme the curve will be. So let's visualize this with a copy to points node. If we copy a sphere into these points and we use a point wrangle here and map this ratio to the p-scale, you can see how we get this information here. If this is a very aggressive turn, we'll have big spheres. And if it's a less aggressive, it will be smaller spheres. And this will be a medium turn here. So there's a thing here that it will get, well, it gets bigger, 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 and then smaller, smaller, smaller. It will be nice to grow until one point, then be constant, and then ramp out. So we get a less aggressive banking here, because this will mean that we'll turn to the max, and then turn back. It will be more natural to turn, keep it constant, and then go back. So let's see how we can do this. We can clamp this ratio, for example, between minus 0.5 and 0.5. So we'll clamp it. And as you can see here, we start growing into the curve, then we keep it constant, and then we ramp out. And as you can see, we don't have that extreme up and down here, and we have this information here. So another thing we can do to make it more gradual, it's to smooth this attribute. And we'll do it right here. Smooth, and well, as you can see, it's a bit more soft, so we get better information of the turn here. Okay, so now that we have this, let's rotate these vectors. And we'll use another point wrangle for this. So how are we gonna do this? We have these vectors here. We need to rotate them around the tangent. And to rotate it, we'll use a matrix multiplication. And this is a very easy thing to do. We'll use an identity matrix that it's a zeroed out matrix three. And we will rotate the matrix as a whole around every point's tangent. And once this is rotated, we will multiply these two vectors here, and they will rotate accordingly around the curve. So let's see how we can do it. Okay, so we will first of all create this matrix. Let's call it rotation, for example. And it will be the identity matrix. So now we'll use the rotate function. The rotate function, rotate, expects a matrix to rotate, the amount that we are gonna rotate it, and the vector that we are gonna rotate it around. So let's start. We'll rotate the rotation matrix. The amount we'll decide now, and the vector around, it's gonna be the tangent. So instead of this, we'll use a channel here, and as you can see, oh yeah, now we need to multiply these vectors with the matrix. So side times equals the matrix, and up times equals the matrix. So now, as you can see, when we rotate this, we'll rotate the vectors. So let's see what this amount needs to be. So if we multiply this amount with the ratio, when we rotate this, you will see how when it turns right, it turns to the right, and when it turns left, it turns to the left. As you can see, exactly how we expect it. See, when we go right, we bank to the right, and when we go left, we bank to the left. Okay, so now that we have this, let's test it out. Let's create another point wrangle to map the normal using the tangent, because this is what the copy to points will need. So if we get a file node here and we copy to points, you can see how it rotates. Let's make a transform here and make it a bit smaller. You can see how it banks this way, or here it banks that way, and we can make it more extreme or more aggressive depending on our needs. But as you can see, this is a pretty nice setup. I hope you enjoyed it. I will try to make more and more videos, and if you have any questions, please comment them below. See you soon, and thank you. Bye bye.